Hello and welcome to this new lecture on the Lattice-Boltzmann method. So before I begin, let me do a short recap of what we have done in the last lecture with regard to the Chapman-Enskog expansion. So recall that we started from the evolution equation in Lattice-Boltzmann, and we basically wanted to, you know, take it further. So we wrote the distribution at time t plus delta t in terms of a Taylor series. So by writing it in terms of Taylor series to up to order delta t cube terms, what we then did was we substituted this number or this equation into this original evolution equation, and then what we obtained was actually this long differential equation where we have these functions fi1, fi2, which are actually obtained from the perturbation series, or which are given in the perturbation series. And then what we started doing was we started looking at, and one more thing that we did was at this point was that we replaced the delta t that appears in this equation by epsilon, saying that epsilon is a small parameter, and that is the whole essence of the perturbation theory. And then we started looking at the individual terms corresponding to the powers of epsilon. So for example, we looked at order epsilon 0 term, which was this equation, and then what we showed was that if we take the 0th order moment, which means that we just sum it up over all directions, we can actually obtain the continuity equation. Of course, we assumed that the order 0 term is actually equal to 0. And now the reason I wanted to do a recap here and explain a few facts which may not have been clear in the last lecture. One of the most important things that you need to remember is that the equation that we're dealing with is actually this equation in the box, in the white box. And what this equation is saying is that we have, in some way, if I replace delta t by epsilon, it would actually tell me in some way how the distributions, the equilibrium and non-equilibrium distributions, are going to vary or are going to evolve with space and time. And so at the end of the day, what I'm doing is I'm taking zeroth and first order moments of this equation, and I'm trying to calculate that if I take the moments of this equation, what would be the governing equation, or what would be the equation, the evolution equation, in terms of macroscopic variables. So that is the whole idea. So by taking a zeroth order moment of this equation, of this entire equation, we obtain that the zeroth order moment first of all gives me order epsilon 0 contribution, which is the continuity equation. And then I proved to you in the last lecture that the order epsilon 1 contribution is actually 0. And by the same logic, if you go to higher order contributions, those will also be 0. So the continuity equation is exactly satisfied. Now, to move forward, so this, remember, the zeroth order moment gave us an equation for density very similar to the zeroth order moment of the distribution function, which gives us mass density. Now if I take the first order moment of fi or of the distribution function, I should actually get momentum flux. So what we'll now look at in today's lecture is what do we get if I take first order moments of this equation, which in many ways I would say is the key equation in this entire process. Okay, equation A. So this holds the key. Now, before we go forward, I'd like to establish two essential identities that will be required in this lecture. The two identities are essentially the second order moment of the distribution function, of the equilibrium distribution function, and the third order moment of the equilibrium distribution function. So just keep in mind that these expressions will be used at some point in today's lecture, and what it basically means is that the second order moment is actually giving me a second order tensor, and a third order moment is giving me a third order tensor. Further, needless to say, delta alpha beta is actually the Kronecker delta, which is equal to 1 if alpha is equal to beta, and if it's 0 if alpha is not equal to beta. Okay, so now let me start today's lecture formally by looking at an additional moment. So let's look at, for starters, the first order movement of this equation and establish what do we get. So what it means is, let's take Ci beta moment of equation 2. So what we'll get is summation. Now look at that, if you look at that equation, it is d by dt plus Ci alpha d by dx alpha. So let's just write that down. So we have d by dt plus Ci alpha d by dx alpha of Fi equilibrium Ci beta plus 1 by tau Fi 1 Ci beta. This is 0 because right hand side will still be 0. And now if I, you know, try and write it in terms of the next step could be, I can write this as d by dt of summation, let's say, over I Fi equilibrium Ci beta plus we can write d by dx alpha summation over I Ci alpha Fi equilibrium Ci beta plus the last one would be 1 by tau summation over I Fi 1 Ci beta. This is 0. If you recall from the last lecture, this last one moment is anyway 0. This Fi equilibrium Ci beta would actually be rho u beta, and this is a moment that I've just written as a second, this is the first identity. So let's write this as d by dt of rho u beta plus d by dx alpha of 1 by 3 rho c square delta alpha beta plus rho u alpha u beta is 0. Let me say this is my equation number 4. And it's a very important equation that you will need. And I think some part of it might be already making sense. This is what is called as the Euler's equation. And we'll be using this. So just remember that this has been obtained by taking the first order moment of the coefficient or of the order absent zero term. Okay. So moving on, let's also recall that from the last lecture, the term corresponding to order epsilon 1, the term was equal to d by dt plus Ci alpha d by dx alpha of Fi 1 plus 1 by 2 d by dt plus Ci alpha d by dx alpha square Fi equilibrium plus 1 by tau Fi 2. And this we simplified to 1 minus 1 by 2 tau d by dt plus Ci alpha d by dx alpha Fi 1 plus 1 by 2 Fi 2. Let me say this is equation 3. I think this was equation 3 in the last lecture. Now, the same way that I've taken Ci beta moment of, or the first order moment of the order epsilon 1 term, I should be taking the same moment of this equation of the order epsilon, or rather epsilon 1 term. So, let's take the Ci beta moment over equation 3. So, what we'll get? We'll get Ci beta over I 1 minus 1 by 2 tau d by dt plus C I alpha d by dx alpha Fi 1 plus 1 by 2 Fi 2. And now let's break this down into individual components or individual summations. So we'll have d by dt of Ci beta Fi 2 rather fi1, sorry, my mistake there, plus 1 minus 1 by 2 tau d by dx alpha of summation ci beta ci alpha fi1 plus 1 by tau summation over I ci beta fi2. Now something I can again recall from the last lecture, which will vanish. So this contribution will vanish and this will also vanish. So what we'll be left with is only 1 minus 1 by 2 tau d by dx alpha of ci beta ci alpha fi1. So I need to somehow compute this to be able to include the order epsilon 1 term into the equation that has come out of the order epsilon 0 moment. Now to solve what this equation or what this term should look like, you know, to simplify it further, because we don't know what fi1 is, this is the key challenge. I will use equation 2. I will use equation 2, which was 1 by tau fi1 is minus d by dt plus ci alpha d by dx alpha of fi equilibrium. And I'm doing this for the reason that I don't know the moments of these non-equilibrium distributions, but I know the moments of the equilibrium distributions. So I'm going to try and replace, which is what I also did in the last lecture, but now I'm saying it explicitly, that I'm going to try and replace the equilibrium or the non-equilibrium distributions by equilibrium distributions. So what it means is, if I take the double moment, or rather the second moment of fi1 from the preceding equation, I could write this as minus tau summation d by dt plus ci alpha d by dx alpha. And now let me also do one more thing. I already know that I'm taking moment with alpha, and alpha is a dummy index in this whole convention, so I'm going to replace that by a variable gamma. So ci alpha, I can write this as fi equilibrium ci alpha ci beta. And now let's look at simplifying this. So we'll get minus tau, and let's start breaking down the summation property. So we'll have d by dt, or let me remove the summation here. So let's start with d by dt. So what the first term that you'll get is summation here. You'll get summation over fi equilibrium ci alpha ci beta, and I already know what that is. So I'm just going to go ahead and substitute that. So this would be 1 by 3 rho c square delta alpha beta plus rho u alpha u beta, plus the next term would be d by dx gamma, and that would now be summation over I. So this you should see now, this will be fi equilibrium ci alpha ci beta ci gamma. And that is the reason, now you can see that the reason I have given you the third moment at the beginning of this lecture, because I want to simplify this term now. So we can write this as minus tau and take out the derivatives, knowing that c square and delta alpha beta are constant. So I can write this as 1 by 3 c square delta alpha beta d rho dt plus d by dt of rho u alpha u beta plus d by dx gamma of 1 by 3 rho c square. Then we'll have delta alpha beta u gamma plus delta beta gamma u alpha plus delta alpha gamma u beta. So this is what we'll get. Now I will use an identity to simplify this thing, especially this term. There is a complicated term here which I need to simplify. So I will use the d by dt of rho u alpha u beta could be written as u beta d by dt rho u alpha plus u alpha d by dt of rho u beta minus u alpha u beta d rho dt. And what I can also do is take it one step further and write this as u beta d by dt of rho u alpha plus u alpha d by dt of rho u beta, and using the continuity equation substitute d rho dt in terms of d rho u gamma dx gamma. So this could be written as plus u alpha u beta d by dx gamma of rho u gamma. So this I have replaced using the continuity equation. Okay, so once we have gone through these steps, now I can substitute this expression which is given by this equation into this term here. It will go here, and then what I can do is I can simplify this, these derivatives as well. Now this is a long process. It is a long process in the sense that you have to go through many, many steps to be able to keep simplifying this entire operation. But let me jump a few steps and show what we'll get. So I will follow on from this point. So what we'll get is, at this point when I simplify this and maybe jump a few of the very long algebra in terms of cancellation of like terms and things, what an intermediate step that you would see would be that this could be written as minus u beta d by dx alpha 1 by 3 rho c square minus u beta d by dx gamma of rho u alpha u gamma minus u alpha d by dx beta of 1 by 3 rho c square minus u alpha d by dx gamma of rho u beta u gamma plus u alpha u beta d by dx gamma of rho u gamma plus 1 by 3 c square u alpha d rho dx beta plus 1 by 3 rho c square du alpha du beta plus 1 by 3 c square u beta d rho dx alpha plus 1 by 3 rho c square du beta dx alpha. And in this case now some terms will cancel. Okay, so this first one will actually go away with this term, and then if I look at the third term, this will actually cancel with the second term of a similar type, which is this term, noting that of course 1 by 3 c square is constant. So these will be cancelled, and what we'll get at this point is minus u beta d by dx gamma of rho u alpha u gamma minus u alpha d by dx gamma of rho u beta u gamma plus u alpha u beta d by dx gamma of rho u gamma plus 1 by 3 rho c square du alpha dx beta plus du beta dx alpha. And this I can now write that this should actually be equal to, if I look at the three terms here that I've formed, the first three terms, okay, these are actually a special case of minus d by dx gamma of rho u alpha u beta u gamma and plus 1 by 3 rho c square du alpha dx beta plus du beta dx alpha. So therefore, having achieved this, now if I go back to the original point where we started, we had the second moment of Fi1 Ci alpha Ci beta. So what we now have is, and somewhere actually I have dropped this minus tau. Okay, so this was actually removed while I was doing this. I was trying to simplify what was inside the parenthesis. So I have only simplified, I should mention here that I have only simplified the terms in the parenthesis. So I need to multiply whatever I have at the end of it by a minus tau. So we'll have summation Fi1 Ci alpha Ci beta to be minus tau 1 by 3 C square du alpha dx beta plus du beta dx alpha minus d by dx gamma of rho u alpha u beta u gamma, and that's it. So now, having come to this point, now let's write the penultimate step. So we can now write the correction to Euler's equation that we have derived coming from the order epsilon 1 term. So coming from the order epsilon 1 term will be, so we had the d by dt of rho u beta term plus a d by dx alpha of 1 by 3 rho c square delta alpha beta plus rho u alpha u beta minus, now if you notice the tau is there, and because it's an order epsilon 1 term, so we'll have to multiply by epsilon times whatever is inside the parenthesis. And more than the parenthesis, please recall that we had something else going on as well there. So we had a 1 minus 1 by 2 tau into d by dx alpha of this thing that we have derived so far. So it's a long expression. So what we get is minus tau epsilon into 1 minus 1 by 2 tau d by dx alpha of, now what happens to be in the parenthesis, which I'm going to write down here, 1 by 3 rho s e square times du alpha dx beta plus du beta dx alpha minus d by dx gamma of rho u alpha u beta u gamma, and this would be everything which is order epsilon square and higher. And for simplicity, I mean for knowing that epsilon is actually, or rather the tau value is constant, one thing that I can do is I can move these numbers inside the parenthesis, because there it would make more sense that it will start appearing like what we should expect in terms of momentum equation. And the other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to replace epsilon by delta t again, because that was the whole that we started with, that idea, right? So we replace that by delta t, and so now what we get is the final form of our equation. So this is d by dt of rho u beta plus d by dx alpha of, and I'm going to split some functions here for some terms here. So the pressure term will actually go to the left hand side, and now I can notice that this delta alpha beta into d by dx alpha should actually be d by dx beta. So we'll have d by dx beta of 1 by 3 rho c square plus d by dx alpha of, we have a 1 by 3 rho cs square anyway inside. Now tau into 1 minus 1 by 2 tau becomes tau minus half into delta t into the next item on this will actually be d u alpha dx beta plus d u beta dx alpha and plus we have everything which is order delta t square comma. Now if you notice this additional term that I have here, this is of order u cube, and for incompressible or rather for weakly compressible flows this term will actually be a very small number. So I can now write that this order, the error is of the order of order delta t square and order u cube. And so I can now look at, so this is the final form of the equation that we obtain by taking the first order moment of the evolution equation when we use perturbation series. And more importantly, let me now compare this with the Navier-Stokes. So let's write the Navier-Stokes, the general form. The general form would be d by dt rho u beta plus d by dx alpha of rho u alpha u beta to be equal to minus dp dx beta plus d by dx alpha of mu du alpha dx beta plus du beta dx alpha without the body force term anyway. And that's what we started, right? We started with the evolution equation, which was a force-free form. Now, if I compare these two equations, the left-hand side is the same. Now, I can make out a few things. I can say that the two equations are the same. The two equations will be the same. If, first of all, I can now see that pressure should be equal to 1 by 3 rho cs square, which is the equation of state, which is what we've been using in LBM so far. And the second property would be that the dynamic viscosity which appears inside the differential should be equal to this whole coefficient here that appears here. So mu would be equal to 1 by 3 tau minus half delta t into rho c square, or if I divide both sides by density, I will get the kinematic viscosity should be tau minus half into 1 by 3 c square delta t. And that is, those are the two fundamental laws that we obey or we start off with in the Boltzmann, in the lattice Boltzmann equation. So now you can see that why we chose the kinematic viscosity to be, you know, tau minus half. And you also now, I hope that you agree that the pressure is a linear function of density, knowing that c square, which is the lattice speed in the model, is actually a constant value. So I would like to stop this lecture here and hope that these two lectures on the Chapman and Skog expansion have brought about some clarity on why the Navier-Stokes and the Boltzmann equation are considered to be, you know, synonymous in terms of the results and also in terms of the, the actual mathematics. So thank you for listening and see you next time.